Could there be extraterrestrial connection to the creation of civilization? Could our goddess be a representation of a star cluster? Could they have connections to these fish people? Hey Shag, will you come in here? Could the Madonna be from outer space? Will you turn down that volume? And what do the Masons think of the Virgin? Could the Madonna be Isis? A lunar deity passed down through the ages, known as a triple goddess, symbolized by the Trinity. She's also symbolized by the Phoenix. Could Isis, goddess of the earth, goddess of the sea, be America's Columbia? Few realize that we even have a goddess. There she stands. We see her all the time. Of course, we have Columbia Broadcasting Systems, Columbia Records, Columbia Sportswear, notice the swastika, University of Columbia, and the Space Shuttle Columbia. But who is this goddess? Our capital is known as the District of Columbia. Who is this Lady Liberty, the torchbearer, Columbia? Some say that she was named after Christopher Columbus for his discovery of America. Manly P. Hall, founder of the American Philosophical Society, says that 20 cities claim Columbus as a native, and that he was most likely a Greek prince. That was shown by his Kabbalistic cipher and his signature there. Thanks. His name, Manly tells us that the ancient mariners had already discovered the Antarctic. They'd already come across the Western continent. America was discovered long ago. So who is this man, Columbus? We don't even know his name. What could it be that he was named after Columbia? I'm hoping to give you the annotated Columbia edition here tonight. So what's in a name? We've got Saint Columba. He was known for chasing off the Loch Ness Monster. He was also known as the Dove of the Church, because, well, Columba is a dove. Columba is also a constellation. And it's interesting that it's very near Sirius. Could we have extraterrestrial roots to our civilization? And finally, the columbine, known for its five-petaled flower. But still, we're no closer to knowing who our mysterious goddess is. She was put up on the Capitol by the Freemasons. And could she be this lunar deity, this triple goddess? And what does that really mean? Could she have roots in ancient Babylon? One such goddess was known as Queen Semiramis, and she was found in the reeds of Babylon. Her mother was a mermaid. She's always been connected with the fish people. She was known as a mother goddess and a warrior goddess, and sometimes both. Her husband was Nimrod, and he built the Tower of Babel, while she crafted the Hanging Gardens. Now, who were these fish people that built Babylon? These are the very same gardens that Saddam Hussein just rebuilt. Now, Saddam Hussein took on a building campaign that compared only to Nebuchadnezzar. As a matter of fact, Saddam Hussein claimed to be Nebuchadnezzar reincarnated. So he rebuilt all the ancient structures of Babylon, rebuilding the Tower of Babel, as it were. And on the stones in the masonry that he used to construct this, he actually put himself there as Nebuchadnezzar. Now, the interesting thing is, in the Bible, Nebuchadnezzar was taken out by the divine whirlwind. So Saddam Hussein even had paintings commissioned to show that he was Nebuchadnezzar, reincarnated. Headline today, USA Today, Saddam Hussein is Nebuchadnezzar reincarnated. He sits in his throne, and even the tour guides occasionally mistake his name. But of course, Nebuchadnezzar was taken out by the divine whirlwind, what we call the Shekinah. It's a Hebrew word. It's the feminine version of God. So when we attacked Baghdad, we of course called it the Shekinah campaign. This was a play on the word Shekinah. And they used the mother of all bombs to blow them up, the Moab. The Moab is the very people that attacked Nebuchadnezzar, the Moabites. So you see a giant game going on here. Hold that second, Shag. Now these troops came in and they stormed the Temple of Nana in Ur and stole the relics out of there. Now, do you think there's something bigger to this picture? When we are given license to loot the ancient temples. Okay, go on. Well, the dome is a symbol of the goddess. So when you see the dome, you'll find that it will be direct relationship to a phallus, which would be on UT campus, the clock tower. Of course, we have the fish people with Columbia, the clock tower, and the phallus. So what do I think of when I'm sitting out there looking at Columbia standing there as she gazes out at herself and all the different art incarnations? Well, I think of the Freemasons. They put her there. And as you can see, the Freemasons have a strong allegiance to Babylon. They don't believe it's the year 2006. For them, it's the year 6006. For the Anno Lucius calendar, it's ancient Babylonian calendar. And we know the Masons incorporate their symbolism into the buildings that they make, just like the ancient Egyptians used to do. So they have their symbols coded in, and it's up to us to decipher what they might mean. So when we look at another phallus, and we find that there is the symbolism embedded in the wall there, and you'll see that we have Venus and Mercury. Well, two Masonic researchers, Knight and Lomas, have found a connection between Mercury and Venus, and they call it the Shekinah. They have found that when Mercury meets Venus before the rising sun in a conjunction, that this light or this symbol means greatness is going to occur. They actually believe that the Shekinah was the symbol that the people followed to find Jesus. So could we be seeing symbols of Mercury and Venus because of the Masons' astrological use of the Mercury-Venus-Shekinah connection? Is this why we called it Shekinah? But who is this goddess of the pentagram? Could this pentagram really be a symbol for her? Well, we've discovered that the Freemasons' Star of Destiny is Sirius, the dog star. And they actually use a symbol to denote Sirius, and it's called the Blazing Star, which is slightly different than the typical pentagram. Now we know Sirius was important to the ancient Egyptians. But what of the Dogon tribe of Mali, Africa? who says that beings from Sirius landed in their mountain range in northern Africa and taught them civilization and the hidden mysteries of their religion. They say that these beings came from Sirius. Here is a Columbia footage above Mali, Africa. Fade me out here, Shag. Have a look as these craft come and land above Earth. Now, this is filmed from the Space Shuttle Columbia's window. And they see these craft come down. The first one came past, and it landed there in the center and began to illuminate. Now the others follow suit, and you will watch as these giant craft, seeming to be 2 to 3 miles in length, line up in a perfectly organized pattern around the central craft and hover there over northern Africa. Now, could these be the Syrians returning? Certainly, a few researchers have come to the conclusion that these craft are from Sirius and are from the water people. The question is, are they friendly? Have they come here to help? Or are these the beings that crafted the civilization that imprisons us right now? Oh yeah, civilization's a trap. It's a prison. And it was crafted long ago by beings from far away. And I'm gonna attempt to prove that to you tonight. So now you see all these craft as they have lit up and they line up around the central saucer there in the center. And what's interesting is that David Sereda actually has managed to decipher hyperdimensional physics out of the craft, out of what they are doing and the rotation of the spiral. They seem to be hyperdimensional, not completely solid. And actually, in some of this footage, you can see right through them. But this would make more sense for travel. Now, you see, I drew this picture when I was 10. And I drew that craft right there in the middle of it. I had never seen it. I only saw the craft this year. But what of the fish people? The Dogon call them the Nomos. And they say that they called them the repulsive abomination as they slithered up out of the water to tell them about Sirius. And now there were discoveries made. Okay, hold that there. There were discoveries made that the Dogons told us that Sirius was a trinary star system. And we actually found out that this was true only just in the last 10 years. How did this Aboriginal tribe of Africa know this and tell us that this is true? And they even told us that the star that surrounds Sirius, that orbits it, Sirius B, which they call Po, is actually the heaviest thing in the universe. And this is turning out to find to be true as well. So now on this picture, I actually drew the Dogon symbol for Sirius. I had never seen the symbol. But something in my consciousness told me to draw this. I had a very conscious thought about it. And I drew it and said, well, that's not very cool, but I put it on all of them anyway. Only 25 years later to come back and find that it's a symbol for Sirius. And then to find the craft right there in the middle. Soon I'll decipher that lizard. And we might find out what the truth is about Draco. As you see here, the symbol on NASA is the blazing star, a pentagram with the rays around it, which is the same symbol that the Dogon use. Now this very symbol, and when this one stops, stop it there. This very symbol, I went here, this is the Philadelphia Lodge. This is the Temple of Benjamin Franklin. This is where a lot of your leaders come and worship and do strange rites and rituals, which we could talk more about. But what I found really interesting is that in each of the corners of the building is the blazing star here in the Egyptian room. And then in the middle is the Dogon symbol for Sirius. Are the Masons aware of this? They put it on their ceiling. Let's move on. We actually sat in the worshipful master's chair there. So is there a reality to these fish people that continually show up through history? And are they good? Or are they bad? We've had both stories, really. Certainly, Ishtar is not known as the nicest goddess. H.P. Lovecraft gave us an interesting, unique view of the fish people and merfolk in his Cthulhu mythos. He wrote this, it's moving a little slow. The Cthulhu mythos tends to paint the merfolk in not the best light. It was taken from the Necronomicon, the Book of the Dead, and given to the New World Order. You think maybe our leaders know about this? So in his movie Dagon, which I highly recommend you go see, he shows how the fish people turned everyone away from God, and it brought them together under their dark lord, Ea. Ea. Cthulhu. Matara. Ea. But for H.P. Lovecraft, these merfolk were no beauties. Well, perhaps they're beautiful. They were also very deadly. But they would corrupt your soul and take you over genetically and then bring you down to the dark one in the deep, the one that ever sleeps. So who are these fish people and why do we keep seeing them? And do they have a connection to our goddess in Sirius? Who is Columbia? Could she be Ishtar, Inanna, these ancient Sumerian depictions of the goddess here, showing her as a warrior and as a fish? Now you go look it up on my website. I've got this all linked on there. And you'll see all these connections between Inanna and Ishtar and Venus. Now, one of these conical crowns has never been found. They've found the crown that goes around it. But could it be that the Egyptians actually were aliens and had conical heads? Certainly, people are finding these conical skulls all over South America. Perhaps they're hidden in Iraq as well. But people are putting up little museums in their house. Oh, that went too fast. Zechariah Sitchin, he deciphered the cuneiform script and came up with an entirely new interpretation for the book of Genesis. The 12th planet is a most intriguing read. And once you've read it and go back and read Genesis again, it becomes a whole different story. He actually shows us how these people, the ancient Sumerians, knew that the planets revolved around the sun back in, well, let's say 5,000 BC. Could have been earlier. They knew that we were in a solar-centric solar system. He called these people the Nephilim, the people of the fiery rockets. Now, the term Nephilim comes from the root Nephal, which means the fallen ones, or those that were cast down. Hold that one. Now he shows us here, and these is, as you can see, is the Fertile Crescent. This is the Red Sea and the Euphrates and the Tigris. And then this is Jerusalem, the central point, which he's figured out to be the communication center. And then you find the different major sites all in perfect concentric circles and used as a perfect spaceport. And once you've read this and you understand how Iraq and Iran are actually the spaceport of the gods, then you also will find that why the pyramids were built and maybe explain why our soldiers stormed the Temple of Nana and Ur. It's perhaps our leaders know something a little more about our ancient past than they're willing to let us know. Could be. Is Pakal working a flying craft? This is the sarcophagus lid for a tomb in Palenque. And when you look at it, he's actually working controls with his hands and his feet. And has a bunch of instrumentation around him. Could it be an ancient depiction? Now here is the Boeing poster for the Prometheus Mars mission. And what you'll see is a sun low on the horizon, because that's a constant motif with these guys, with two astronauts going on top of a hill finding Sumerian architecture on Mars. Now I'll tell you, both HW and W have pushed for a manned mission to Mars. Could it be that Mars was this ancient city or ancient continent of Atlantis, that white people are actually from Mars and came and landed in the Caucasus Mountains and took over this planet? Could be. And certainly Boeing has no problem showing you Sumerian architecture on Mars. But first they need to send up the Phoenix, right? Back to the goddess symbolism. The Phoenix is the birther of nations, the birther of... So the European Space Agency went ahead and they shot up their, believe it or not, Venus Express. Okay, the Venus Express is just now starting to send us back pictures of the Venus landscape. I'm very curious to see what anomalies we'll find there. I often go to my favorite researcher, Richard Hoagland, as he showed me this picture here. Stop that right there, Shang. This is Iapetus. This is a moon surrounding Saturn, orbiting Saturn. It has been shown to have a 12-mile-high wall surrounding the equator, the perfect equator, right? Perfect wall. You see it right there sticking out of the picture. And it is shown to have tetrahedral designs in the craters. They're not round. And if you go look at the 3-page study on enterprisemission.com, or it's also linked to my website, freemanperspective.blogspot.com, you'll find that this is not a planet, but a Death Star, a space station, but ancient. So could these be cave paintings of flying saucers or ancient depictions of flying saucers? I mean, this has been a motif that has been around longer than 1950. This is something that's been going on this planet forever. Now, you think Da Vinci might have had a little bit of a knowledge of what was going on? Has the arrival occurred in the past? All of these ancient depictions. Look at this guy. Pull that forward, Shag. This has a... Are these ancient depictions of astronauts, of people in spacesuits? And these are all ancient shots of from South America, Egypt. Now here, are they preparing a candidate to get him ready for the rocket launch? I've got some other shots in here that show him actually climbing into the rocket. And these are not people that were backwater people. This is not, I mean, we've never compared to the architecture that the Egyptians have created. Here's another ancient picture showing flying craft. Now, this is the crucifixion of Jesus with flying saucers or flying craft sitting there. Look at this guy manning his craft. Now, I haven't gotten the dates on this because this is the informal version of Columbia. I'm giving you guys a little bit of an annotated version of the new Columbia episode. All right, move on. And there are absolutely constant images of people in craft. Now, we couldn't have deciphered these things in the past because we didn't know about flying humans in the past. So we tell you, oh, it's an ancient symbol of the sun. Is that still rolling? Constantly, we come up with this motif of the winged disc. And strangely, you know, it seems to fit our interpretation of jets or just the winged men themselves, known that they were for flying, and they'd always wear these interesting outfits. So now we know that the five-pointed star, the blazing star, and the goddess, Isis, are symbols of Sirius. But what about Orion? Isis, or this is Lilith, another version of the goddess. Now check this picture out. This has Isis standing there. Are those fish scales I see? Could I, and could we be talking about fish people from Sirius? Because Isis is the Egyptian symbol of Sirius. But Orion, the one symbolized by the phallus, Osiris. Osiris is a symbol of Orion. So here we have the goddess Isis with her torch, or Columbia, whichever you prefer, on the obelisk. The conjunction of Sirius and Orion has been told to us by Dr. Sala as the progenitors of the Earth, as the creating race. Orion is known as the hunter as well, so was Nimrod of the Bible. So could this explain the constant use and absolute madness involved in crafting all of these symbols? Could this explain why we have a phallus in due relation to the capital breast? Because we are a planet that is ruled by beings from Sirius and Orion. Are those fish scales on Osiris? Well, the fish people, they didn't fade away. We have not seen 90% of our seas. Now, here we have. Oh, wait. I missed that one. That is Enlil. He's sometimes known as Bel. He's also known as Ea. And he's depicted as having a fish head with human body. Could this be the purpose behind the Pope's hat? Could the Pope be in an unholy allegiance with the fish people? Is that why the Vatican has a massive store underneath the Vatican that has watching the Hubble and watching outer space? And could these fish people have come to this planet in ancient craft? And hold that one a second, Chang. And generated human beings on this planet in their labs. Now, this picture has been around for 5,000 years. We never could understand. Could it be that they are showing us that they genetically crafted us to be their worker slaves? Now, the interesting thing to note, the difference between apes and humans. Webbed fingers. Humans swim. Humans actually, have webbed fingers, webbed toes, our hair flows with water. Apes, nope. Apes won't jump in the water. Apes won't get anywhere near the water. There's a big difference between apes and humans, and it has to do with aquatic beings. All right, move on. So I've always had an interest in the goddesses. Now here we have the, wait, go back, well, the Temple of Hatshepsut. Yeah, go back to that for a second if you can. The Temple of Hatshepsut is very interesting because it was crafted, well, millennia ago. Can you not back that up? And it is said to have been built by Imhotep. And it is actually crafted out of the cliff and constructed right into the mountainside. Oh, I don't know. Are these backwater people? Doesn't seem like it to me. All right, move on, Shag. No, these guys. They build in this grand style. Now, this is the Temple of Hathor, another goddess, and they were held very high regard. Now, Hathor, keep going. Hathor was known as a cow goddess, right? She's also been connected with Isis on certain levels, right? Just like El, see? So, in the temple of, I mean, look at the structures. Okay, well, first you're going to notice the phallus nature here, right? And then, of course, these massive structures, these incredible artwork. I mean, we cannot compare with this today. Well, especially in our financial state of distress. But there's no way that humans can compare with this at this time. All right, keep rolling. So down in the temple of Ramses in Abydos. There's a hieroglyphic script That actually talks about the Pharaoh defeating his enemy. Yeah, I would imagine that he would would defeat his enemy with these particular accoutrements. Yeah, we have a helicopter. Keep rolling, Chegg. A tank, or perhaps a submarine. A land speeder? Well, we've already found a Death Star. Why not a land speeder? And could this be the Phoenix? Back to the Phoenix goddess symbolism. It runs everywhere. So have ancient astronauts visited our planet? Have they seeded civilization? Is that an octopus standing next to that gray? Well, one group certainly thinks that we have, and they are known as the Raelians. And Ra'el was a race car driver from France until he was contacted by an extraterrestrial race who said they created us genetically. And they gave Ra'el a message. They told him to prepare humanity for their arrival. Told him to build an embassy in Israel for the Nephilim to return. But the symbol the Nephilim gave Ra'el offended a few people for its Kabbalistic roots, or perhaps worse. Did the Nazis have knowledge of all this? It certainly seems so. So they took the swastika out of the symbol, but it still remains an ancient symbol of the sun. So let's see what Ra'el.
Science should be our religion, because thanks to science, we are becoming gods. We are becoming eternal, and we are becoming pure consciousness.
Becoming gods. Well, now, the Raelians claim to be able to clone humans, and he actually stood before Congress, the ambassador of our extraterrestrial gods, and told them, in the beginning, the Nephilim created mankind through genetic manipulation. And we will do no different. Listen to it from your
own. It will be done anyway, somewhere, someday, as thankfully, nothing can stop science.
They're going to do it anyway. So they announced the birth of Eve on December 25th, 2001. Now, do you believe them? Do you believe these people cloned humans? They certainly do. They say they've cloned them, and these girls came out to announce it. These are Raelians, by the way. Very sexy cult.
I'm very, very pleased to announce that the first baby clone is born. She was born yesterday at 11:55 a.m.
Is this lady a fish person?
In the country where she was born, so this will not give you more details about the location. She's fine. We call her Eve.
Yes, Eve. That was Brigitte Bousselet, the head scientist for Clone Aid. So, yeah, you're starting to see the picture here? We've got our goddess with her fallen angel wings. She's carrying the torch, being drawn forward by fish people. And then just to her left, a pentagram. Of course, in Texas, we're used to seeing the pentagram quite often, but you ever wonder what it means? And the pentagram hung over Bethlehem for the Y2K celebration. I wonder what the Christians felt about that. Of course, not many people question this. They don't, you know, who thinks about this stuff but me? And of course, they released the Columba doves. Because this whole celebration of Y2K was a series of rituals to Hades and the goddess. The Freemasons attempted to cap the Great Pyramid with gold. Hold that a second, Shag. Now, there's a little interesting side note. When the Freemasons were preparing to cap the Great Pyramid with gold on Y2K, and most people were concerned about the computer meltdown. I myself kept saying, well, they're capping the Great Pyramid with gold. You know, this to me meant a whole lot more than a computer meltdown. Because, you know, on the dollar bill, we got the pyramid floating, and then it lands upon the, when the job is done. I can't seem to talk tonight. But the interesting thing was Egyptian Flight 990. Here, hold that there. Egyptian Flight 990 left out of LaGuardia and was to fly to the Giza Plateau prior to the capping of the Great Pyramid. But instead, it flew back and it picked up 33 Egyptian military at Wright-Patterson, and then it went down and picked up JPL scientists at Edwards. Neither one of these military bases has ever had a public airliner land in their military base. And then they took off for the Giza Plateau before the capping. 33 Egyptian military and a scientist from Jet Propulsion's laboratory. Well, the plane took a nosedive into the ocean. Now, here, are we showing, and of course, then they didn't cap the Great Pyramid with gold. Are we seeing here a ritual that symbolizes the river Styx?
What they're going to try to do in 2 minutes. The sun, as the Earth spins around, the sun is actually traveling across the sky at about a mile every 2.5 seconds. They are going to light the Thames on fire. It is called a river of fire.
A river of fire. That's what we call the river Styx. Now, the Bee Gees. Hold that a sec. The Bee Gees. I couldn't figure out why the Bee Gees were all in this thing, and then until I realized that they were in Sunrise, Florida. Yeah. All right. Go on. And Clinton announced,
"It is a rising sun."
Mm-hmm. What does that mean? You know, we're talking about the rising sun. We're talking about the Shekinah. We're talking about Orion and Osiris. We're talking about Sirius and Columbia.
Midnight has come.
The Brotherhoods ignited their phallus. Freemasons crafted those things. Freemasons crafted these things. What do you think they mean by it? Now, in England, they only had Old Ben. They only had the male representation. Because I think America was the goddess, and they were the male, Osiris. But so then they built the Millennial Dome to have the feminine version right across the water from where they were. Because every good king deserves his queen, right? The cow goddess, yes. So from the capital breast, straight on to the phallus, because every goddess needs her phallus. Perhaps. There's some people going, I don't know about that. So here you see we have the five-pointed star on Benedict Hall, and the five-pointed star is connected to Venus. Because Venus actually makes a five-pointed star every 8 years when viewed from Earth. It makes a perfect five-pointed star. But Venus is also, well, sometimes it's known as the morning star, and sometimes as the evening star. But Venus is also symbolized by the shell. So this will explain to you why Texaco and shell. So here at the Statue of Columbia, just in case you thought the pentagram was too normal, there's the shell of Venus, just to her other side.
Let the brother receive the light.
And the Masons call it receiving the light. We're going to talk a little more about this movie on the next one. This is from hell. So the candidate stands in the embrace of the 5 points of fellowship as the worshipful master directs his gaze to a five-pointed star standing between the two towers of Jachin and Boaz, and behind him, a skull and bones. He is told to look to the two columns in the five-pointed star and know that these are a symbol of Venus, the star of the morning. And she is known as the Eye Goddess. I mean, interestingly, Ayin in Hebrew, and this all goes back to Hebrew, is the devil card. In the Bible, the star of the morning is Lucifer. Sometimes it's put as son of the morning, star of the morning. And you see here, the definition of sun of the morning, star of the morning, clearly signifies a bright star, and is most likely what we call the morning star, Venus. So, Lucifer, is Venus. Now, a friction match in the dictionary is a lucifer. And then notice the oblong square. Wait, go back. The oblong square, of course, is one of their main symbols. It's the position that they put their feet in when standing before the worshipful master. But the connection between Lucifer and Satan only happened in Paradise Lost, in Dante's Inferno, in Milton's Paradise Lost. This is where we got the connection between Lucifer and Venus, or Lucifer and the Satan. Never in the Bible is Lucifer ever connected with Satan. All right, let's move on. This here is a Lucifer factory. Now, Venus pictures might give us a bit of a clue. Now, hold that a second, Shag. Let me just tell you, Phoenix Pictures makes movies about child labor camps starring Sigourney Weaver, right? They called it Holes, cloning, The Sixth Day with Arnold Schwarzenegger, Nazi Love, which is The Apt Pupil written by Stephen King, and all of these I've shown to you before. Well, at least, you know, I've shown you Stephen King is definitely a brother. So Phoenix Pictures, let's look at their logo and see if we can decipher what they're cloning. Nazi Love, child labor camps. So Phoenix shows us in their logo, they strike a Lucifer, which becomes a sun low on the horizon, because it is a rising sun. And it boils up into the fiery phoenix, which of course is the symbol of the goddess in the resurrection. So can we say Lucifer Pictures? Absolutely. That's exactly what they're trying to tell you. And in Clive Barker's Nightbreed, we get another clue.
Hello. I'm Clive Barker.
Tonight, you leave the natural world behind. The life you lived will be a dream.
I know.
The blood of Baphomet knows all truth.
Now notice, he strikes a Lucifer at the mention of the name Baphomet. Well, Baphomet is known as a hermaphroditic god, or goddess, I guess it's both, right? He was worshipped by the Templars. Is that rolling? And Templars became a version of the Masons. They actually became the Masons later on. And you'll see that he has the phallus of Caduceus in his lap, and one arm pointing up and one arm pointing down. This is an ancient symbol of the alchemist, to show you the universe created through good and bad, through dark and light. That was it's the very epitome of Mercury, as above, so below. And now our goddess has one more symbol that we haven't gotten to yet. She's known by an owl. And now you understand Hooters. But you see in ancient Babylon, even Athena, or Minerva, constantly the goddess is depicted with an owl. Even Isis, shown with the owl. Our capital is surrounded by an owl. Mazda is symbolized by an owl. And in Austin, we have our own little special owl, the Frostbank Tower, which happens to have a pyramid up in its roof and was designed by the same guy who put the pyramid with 666 panes of glass in front of the Louvre. So perhaps our brothers at Bohemian Grove are national leaders that do ritual sacrifice, and perhaps real sacrifice out at Bohemian Grove. Aren't worshiping. Are you rolling? Don't stop unless I tell you to stop. Molech. Molech is a bull god. Columbia. Isis is the owl. Lucifer. But they're not talking. But there will be sacrifices.
A solemn death.
Never to reveal our secrets, under no less a penalty than
my throat be cut across.
Okay, stop it there. Now, this movie, From Hell, when it came out, I was rather surprised. I don't know if we're going to make it to the end of this. I was rather surprised when From Hell came out, because I saw the big mace and compass square and G on the preview, and I was like, oh my God, what are they doing? And then this movie is all about how Jack the Ripper is a Freemason and therefore couldn't be prosecuted in a court of law because all the Masons are lawyers and judges and everything else, and they made sure that he didn't get prosecuted. This is an old conspiracy theory. Well, I said, why are they putting this on the air? I said, they must need a new Ripper, you know? Maybe they're trying to get somebody to come to him and say, hey, I want the job the Ripper was given. And the very next week, I said, you watch. There's going to be another Ripper in the newspaper. Well, sure enough, it wasn't Ripper, but it was Sniper the very next week. I don't know. It may just be a coincidence, but that was my prediction, and it came true. All right, let's
be torn out by its root.
Try and make it through all of this. So what is she thinking as she's gazing out at herself on top of the Capitol breast, as she sees herself as the Frostbank Tower, this goddess of Owl, this Lucifer, fallen angel? Could she be our symbol of the fish people from Sirius to show our allegiance with the rulers of this planet? Could Madonna be a representation of this goddess Columbia and later pass this on to Britney Spears? They certainly seem to epitomize what this goddess is all about. And they say at the end times, the whore of Babylon will return. Could we be seeing this? And is she from outer space? Well, hopefully I've given you some credible
proof. There's a goddess waiting to be discovered. New Venus disposables. Venus, reveal the goddess in you.
All right. Now, I put that Venus commercial up on there because, well, Gillette's symbol is a square. And, every single corporate logo that I use absolutely fits within this entire thing that I'm explaining to you through corporate logos in Columbia. Now, I hope to get Columbia done here in the next week or so and, get this a little more organized, get my script written. I was kind of winging it tonight. I wanted to look at it. This is the first time I've seen this new version, and so you all are getting to experience that with me. But, I sit out here and I see this goddess. I see these symbols. I see the pentagram in the shell. I see the ABC logo, the NBC logo, the CBS logo. And, I realize that all of our connections of all of the symbolisms go back to Venus. And even these same researchers, Knights and Lomas, which I'll have these guys hooked up on my website by tomorrow, we'll show you that the connection between the shock and awe and the conjunction of Venus and Mercury as it rises before the sun. And they also tell us that America actually means Venus. I don't have that book with me, so I can't explain that further, but I'll make sure that it's all linked up there. So what is this Venus connection? What is the Venus Express going to find when it gets to, when it starts sending back these images? Because certainly the Cassini satellite sending back pictures of the Death Star were a bit of a shock. But the people just, it's not true. This doesn't affect our day-to-day life, even though it's all around us. Now what you're seeing here is videotape from the Columbia space shuttle of these craft. And look at them all. And what has happened here is that they were extending a tether to gather electricity out of space. But it actually gathered way too much electricity and it broke the tether. And it floated off and became that seemingly neon light that's floating down there. So that's actually a long tether. And then now the astronauts, they're kind of tripping out while they're watching this whole thing. Because all of a sudden, all these crafts start flying around, Look at them all. They're all in our atmosphere. They're doing things out there. They're out there right now. This is just, maybe 6 years old, this footage. So, have they returned? Have the Nephilim returned? Are they preparing us for their arrival? Well, the ambassador of our extraterrestrial gods already speaks before Congress openly about this, claims to be cloning humans, and then our Mason leaders are all embedding the code within all the architecture around us. If I can get around this country and get all of it filmed for you, I'm going to try and do that this summer. Because the constant showing of Venus and Mercury, of the hermaphrodite, all of these have absolute meaning, and it goes to outer space. But of course, we could have never seen any of this beforehand, because we didn't know about space travel. We didn't know about genetic manipulation. We couldn't have thought that men were flying in planes back in that time. We, you know, history has been erased from us, and it continues to do so. I mean, if you guys are really worried about the gas prices and the heat, start to, you know, checking into Tesla's technologies and see that in 1930, we already had an electric car that could run 90 miles an hour for days without ever using any sort of power whatsoever. It ran off of air, you know, it just took it right out of the ether. So now they want to tell us that these craft have arrived and they're coming to save us from our evil selves. But when I look at civilization, I see that this has all been manufactured, that this whole setup has come to us from these extraterrestrials. And so now what is happening is they're working to devastate this planet to such a point that we have no hope but to turn to them for our survival.